United States of America, known as Land of the Free, Home of the Brave, has come to symbolize freedom throughout the world. People from all nations and from all walks of life have called the United States home. The United States has welcomed them with open arms. Indeed, the famed Statue of Liberty is the embodiment of this dream. In New York's public education system alone, its student body represents 145 countries. The United States has a deep affinity with Supreme Master Qinghai. With her boundless love and compassion, Supreme Master Qinghai has provided humanitarian assistance to many parts of the United States. In 1993, she sent relief teams to provide financial and material assistance to the victims of the six Midwestern states that were severely affected by heavy rain and flooding. On December 27, 1997, at the benefit concert, A Journey Through Aesthetic Realms, Supreme Master Qinghai generously contributed $100,000 each to the Vietnam Children's Fund and the U.S. Department of Veterans Affairs. The following year, at another benefit concert, One World of Peace Through Music, she once more contributed generously, with two charity organizations being the recipients of her love. St. Jude Children's Research Hospital received $150,000 and the Starlight Children's Foundation received a check for $100,000. Additionally, in the face of one of the worst human tragedies ever to occur on U.S. soil, on September 11, 2001, Supreme Master Qinghai responded immediately, sending relief teams from around the country and all over the world to Ground Zero in New York City. Supreme Master Qinghai's financial contributions amounted to over $300,000 to organizations aiding the victims. To this day, Supreme Master Qinghai continues to extend her loving compassion to all parts of the U.S., from Virginia, Ohio, Kentucky, and Alabama, to California, Florida, Texas, Hawaii, and other states. We now invite you to listen to the following lecture by Supreme Master Qinghai, entitled, The Way to Gain the Kingdom of God is Through Enlightenment, given on February 24, 1991, in Boston, Massachusetts, USA.
Supreme Master Qinghai's lectures are not a complete meditation instruction. Please do not try alone. For free of charge guidance, please visit www.godsdirectcontact.org or contact any of our centers near you.
Well, I guess some of the things I have said that you have known already. In case you want some more clarification or anything you do not agree with me or do not understand, please don't hesitate to give me your opinion or question. We could start now. And you know, our life is eternal, but my time here is not, so please, please don't hesitate.
So we have this eternal consciousness.
Yes.
And you're saying to get in touch with that while we're alive. So my question is, it seems a lot of people are talking about that happening in the next 10 years where people are becoming more alive. How do we still live and feed this body while we are taking care of our spiritual body?
Oh.
Balance.
Oh, yes.
That's my question.
Well, it's not difficult as you think. You see, for example, Annette, she's still here. She's still eating and she's still working. She's a teacher. And she even does two jobs, teaching at night and learning in the daytime, and then still taking care of her spiritual attainment, you know, when she has time. Yeah, we have to prepare our schedule. Most of our times are lost in idle gossip, in too much long telephone chattering, too many nonsense advertisements on the newspapers, or watching TV when we don't want to watch it. Many times you switch on the TV and you don't even want to watch it, but because it's on, you leave it. And just watching, you know. And when we have a definite purpose and definite schedule, we share the time, you know, like time to go to school, time to go to work, and time for meditation. And in the time of meditation, you don't gossip, you don't talk, you don't answer telephone, etc. You put it off for the next moment, and that's okay. Many people don't die without talking to us, you know. We just think we're so important. First, we take care of our intelligence, mean open up more of our great reservoir of wisdom. And then we can take care of people even better. We learn faster. We work more efficiently. We contribute more to the world. Not that we just lean on the spiritual side and forget the world. No, it's not true. I'm still working. You don't know. I paint. I sing. I lecture. I do painting. I sell them. Get the money for lecture and that. You know, I'm working very hard, no?
Thank you.
Yes, it's very easy to do it. Very easy. If I can do it, you can.
So sometimes to be selfish, to be self-fulfilling, to take time out for yourself.
Yes.
Selfish for yourself.
It's not selfish, sir.
Take care of yourself.
It's not selfish, sir.
So other people might call it that.
Yes. For example, if you take time to eat, because after a whole day working for the society, you already are tired and hungry. You need to fill in some energy. It's not selfish. Well, if for this body alone, so ephemeral and short-lived, we have to work so hard and invent so many things and cook so many meals to feed it, how much more must we take time to feed our spiritual body or aspect, whatever you call it? It's not selfish. It is the right way to do. It's because we are not used to it. We used to do things in the hard way, in the wrong way, and now we get the correct way. We think it's selfish. It's not true. If everybody in the world never eats, and you feel hungry and you eat, they think you're selfish. But we should eat, yeah, inside and outside. It is because we don't eat this kind of spiritual food. Therefore, we are hungry, we suffer, and we are ignorant. We don't know what to do next, and we are so struggling. And we always lost in this life. Yes? That's all. Okay, it's not selfish. It's absolutely unselfish.
Well, thank you. Love to you.
Thank you.
Maybe I'll read a couple questions and give people a chance to be courageous enough to come up. Okay.
Yes.
Some English questions first. Master, how about God's word, the Bible? You didn't mention it. It says in one of the scriptures that salvation is a gift from God that we don't earn through good work. Jesus Christ died for our sins and gives us eternal life through accepting Him as Lord and Savior. Please explain.
Yes, salvation is a gift from God. We cannot earn it through charity, to virtuous life, but these things help. Help what? Help our peaceful feeling. If we do some good things, we are virtuous, we feel more balanced, more virtuous. And when we try to find God, there's not much obstacles, no guilty feeling to stop us, to make us feel uneasy. You understand? So they help. But we don't earn it through virtuous life and through charitable deeds. That is correct. Jesus died to save our sins. That is also correct. Now, when Jesus was alive, He was a great master. He emphasized that the kingdom of God is only through Him. What does that mean? It means through a living master. He didn't say that He will be always eternally the master, you know. He said, as long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. And after He said, don't grieve for me because I will send comforters to you. That means that there will be another master who comes. The spirit is eternal. How can Jesus die? He will live again and again and again through us, through other enlightened beings. We must make ourselves become like Jesus. Then we can manifest His salvation. We can prove His salvation. Otherwise, if we live our daily life just very ignorant, low level, low thinking, how can we prove that Jesus has saved us? We have to prove it. If we want to understand that Jesus really saved us, we must be in a saintly level. Otherwise, it's just discussing, talking. We don't know anything about Jesus. How can we really understand Him? How can we really appreciate Him? Jesus is a man, but Christ is a power. Now that power can be transmitted anytime, any place, through anyone who is qualified. You understand? It's like electricity can go through any wires, if that wire is okay, is in order, good condition, and if there's a plug. Now, I just offer you a way to plug in with Jesus Christ, with Christ's power. And then you understand what Christ is, and you really appreciate Him. Otherwise, I think we just talk about Jesus Christ, but we do not understand, and we do not get any salvation from it. Jesus died for mankind. It was at His time. Because whenever a living master is on earth, the master takes on some of the bad karma of the people, especially those who believe in the master, and especially those who are disciples of the master. And that bad karma has to be worked out. Therefore, the master suffers for the disciples and for mankind at large in his lifetime, and it manifests through his body. Therefore, he might be sick, he might be ill, he might be tortured, he might be nailed on the cross, or he might be slandered, he might be persecuted. Any master has to go through this kind of things. You see it yourself. Even Buddha, Mohammed, Christ, and many other masters in the East and West. No one has ever lived their life peacefully without persecution. That is what it means by a master sacrifice for mankind. But only as long as he has the body to suffer the bad karma. You understand? Because karma in this world is physical. If you want to save the people out of the physical bad karma, you need a physical body. Therefore, master has to manifest a physical body to take on all this trouble and suffering and work it all out. Because the master is a great reservoir of grace and blessing. Therefore, his body can take on anything at all. But doesn't mean that he doesn't suffer. Therefore, Jesus has suffered for mankind. It's correct. But as long as he is in this world only. And after he, someone else has to suffer. Some other master has to come and take care of the next generation. Otherwise, how do you explain the suffering continuing in this world? If Jesus has saved all mankind, why do they still live in ignorance? Why do they still kill each other? He can only when he's here. Now he's gone to the other world and do all the work. Other masters come here to work. All right?
Master, what is the Kuan Yin method?
Kuan Yin method? Guan means observation, and Yin means the sound. The sound means the word in the Bible. You know, in the beginning was the word, the vibration. And the word was with God, and the word was God. Everything was made by it, and nothing is made that is not made by this. So, when we get in touch with this so-called word, yeah? Because in the old time they called vibration word. Well, you must know, word vibrated. So, when we get in touch with this vibration, which was with God and which is God, then we are in touch with God. And we truly understand what is God like, and we are one with God again. And we do things from God's dictation and not from our own ego, and we will not do wrong anymore. Even if we want to do wrong, it will be difficult. Just like now, if we want to do right, it is difficult.
As you use the word God, do you mean it is a synonym for Buddha nature, enlightenment, nirvana,
yes,
etc.?
Yes. Same.
Some say that the truly enlightened one are of no mind, that they do not act in this world. They are only observers. They make no choices. They only flow like the river. How does one live in this world without acting, without choosing? It is also said by some that to act upsets the balance of nature, and nature will compensate by creating opposites. Is this true?
Well, you have to be enlightened first, and then you know what it is. Otherwise, how can I tell you when you're not there? But I'll try. But please don't blame me if you do not understand. To act without acting doesn't mean you are lifeless or soulless or mindless or anything like that. You just do things very naturally, and then, well, I cannot say it. I just know it. It is true what it is said there, that when you are enlightened, you don't do things. You don't have choice anymore. Truly, it is like that. You're one with God. You do only God's will. And you know exactly it is like that. Even though outwardly it looks like you're doing the same thing with others. But it's not so. Everything is dictated by God. You just feel no responsibility. But you do always the right thing, never wrong. And that's the trouble. Yes. Now we cannot say that everyone else who act irresponsibly is acting the will of God. It's not true. They don't know what the will of God is. After enlightenment, we know what is the universal plan, and we act accordingly. And before enlightenment, we're just upsetting everything, trying to force our will into the plan of nature. Now, for example, on a stage, a good actor and actress know their role and memorize their script, and they say and do and act accordingly to the whole setup of the drama and to the dictate of the director of the drama. But some who are lousy, who don't like to know it, or who like to earn money only and just to be on the stage, but don't do their work, you know, don't try to know their role properly, do not try to know the drama motive and instruction, and do not like to follow the plan of the director, then he will make a wrong on the stage, you know, and upset the whole thing. That's the difference between a good actor and a lousy one. Yeah? And he doesn't even memorize his script, and when he come on the stage, he just say what he should not say. And what he should say, he doesn't say. Or instead of just slapping the opponent just a little bit like this, and he really slapped very hard and make him faint it on the stage. So the director has to stop the whole thing and make it again, and it's troublesome. And he has to interfere, you know, that's it.
Master, can you give proof of rebirth or life after death?
Do I have to give proof? Can I do it now, here? I think you're asking the impossible. You read enough books, newspapers, reports, TVs, also research, yeah. And you have enough reports about this phenomena. Need you ask me here on this stage to prove it to you? I won't.
Master, who is God? Buddhism doesn't accept the notion of God. What do you think about this idea? Is God just invented by the people to educate or to explain events?
Yeah, God is inventive. In the sense of human understanding, but God exists as God is. Yeah? No explanation about God is sufficient. And no explaining about God should be ever attempted. But everybody talk about God. God is this, God is that, God is other. Of course, so Buddha is fed up, he said, no God. I say the same, if people always bothering me about who God is and what God should do and where God should stay, you know, and I would say, no such God. Yeah.
What else can you say to such people who always insist on their own imaginary God? They paint a picture of an ugly God, of an ignorant God, who just listens to the dictate of mankind all the time. Everybody pray to God, pray different things, and God has to do different things. And God is so limited according to this kind of conception. So Buddha say, no such God, that's all. But Buddha say in the other time that, I do not tell you there is God or there is no God, but I tell you there's one thing. From this all things come, and to this all things return. Now you tell me what that is.
What is that? Huh? God, okay. Why do not just pick out one sentence and attack him, you know? Buddha is enlightened. He knows what he's talking about.
Master, would you explain how to meditate, the time, how often, and what technique to be successful?
There are many techniques for tranquilizing our mind, for being more intelligent, being more efficient in our work. And you might choose any techniques that you like. But we offer the so-called what in my belief, the one direct contact with God. Yeah? If you want to know yourself, God means our own nature, our own noble quality, our own highest wisdom. That's why it is said that the kingdom of God is within you, or the Buddha is within each of us. Yeah? Otherwise it would say the Buddha is in Nirvana, God is in heaven, or something like that. Now when we want to find God or find our own true noble quality, noble position, then we have to follow the Guan Yin method. The Guan Yin method means we are in contact with the vibration, the original power of the universe, the God. Okay?
I think you answered this question. How does one know when we are enlightened? It's become in contact with that, right?
Ah, yes. How does one know? How do you know when you give birth to a child? Huh? Is it so difficult?
This person would like to know, where and when did you first see the Supreme Light of God?
When was the first time? Oh, should I make a data out of it? I forgot it already. Yeah? I'm very bad with dates. Please forgive me. I forgot what date it was. Maybe it was a Sunday, okay?
I think this question is about vegetarian. If animals can hunt for food, why can't people? In nature, hunting is the normal pattern of life. Is not humanity an integral part of that nature? An integral part of that nature, nature being animals hunt for food, we are also animal? We can hunt for food?
If we want to be more noble, to call ourselves human, and we should try to understand what a human should do and how a human should live his life to make an example for our younger brothers and sisters. If we live the same life as our younger brothers and sisters, which are animals, then we cannot be worth it in God's creation. Because God said in the Old Testament, the first chapter is that man should lead animal. You understand? We should be in the superior position to all the animals. I do believe that humans should be superior to other beings, should lead a noble life to make an example. Because these animals will evolve. These animals will evolve and become human next. And if they see our bad examples, how would they become better? And we should be their teacher. We are the elders.
Some of the diseases related to meat consumption and or production: rabies, anthrax, sleeping sickness, Q fever, norovirus, swine flu, Ebola Reston virus. Cured meats and fish increase leukemia risk in children. Antibiotic-resistant superbug infections from a strain of Staphylococcus aureus. Blue tongue disease, E. coli, Salmonella, bird flu, mad cow disease, or Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease, 90% of the population at risk. Pig's disease, or PMWS, listeriosis, shellfish poisoning, preeclampsia, Campylobacter, Clostridium difficile, diseases hidden in healthy appearing livestock.
Some of the costs of meat eating.
Infertility. Eating just one serving of meat per day increases the risk of women's infertility by 32%, with additional meat consumption increasing the risk.
Heart disease. Over 17 million lives lost globally each year. cost of cardiovascular disease is at least $1 trillion a year.
Cancer. Increased childhood cancers and adult reproductive cancers from hormones in meat.
Colorectal cancer. Over 1 million new colon cancer patients diagnosed each year. More than 600,000 colon cancer-related mortalities annually. In the United States alone, colon cancer treatment costs about $6.5 billion. Millions of people are newly diagnosed with other meat-related cancers every year.
Diabetes. 246 million people are affected worldwide.
An estimated $174 billion spent each year on treatment in just the United States. Obesity. Worldwide, 1.6 billion adults are overweight, with 400 million more who are obese. Costs $93 billion each year for medical expenses in the United States alone. At least 2.6 million people die annually from problems related to being overweight or obese.
Environmental. Use up to 70% of clean water. Pollute most of the water bodies. Deforest the lungs of the earth. Uses up to 43% of the world's cereal. Uses up to 85% of the world's soy. Cause world hunger and wars. 80% cause of global warming. Plus more.
Some of the costs of milk consumption. Cowpox from milking cows. Bacterial microbes, pesticides, and enzymes found in cheese derived from the inner stomach linings of other animals. Up to 80% of the calories in cheese are from pure fat. Breast, prostate, and testicular cancer from hormones present in milk. Listeria and Crohn's disease. Hormones and saturated fat leads to osteoporosis, obesity, diabetes, and heart disease. Linked to higher incidences of multiple sclerosis. Classified as a major allergen. Lactose intolerance. Plus more.
For help quitting, please visit
For more urgent information, please visit www.suprememastertv.com/killers.
I have one question with a picture attached. Master, what does this picture mean, drawn by a 7-year-old? I ask you respectfully.
Who wrote this one? I don't know.
So can you tell what it means? She doesn't know. She's asking you.
Who asked this?
I believe the mother wrote the question that this picture was drawn by her 7-year-old. Do you know what it means?
All the children, they draw what they like. They have great imaginations. Otherwise, you ask her yourself. It's your daughter, why you ask me? She should know. Oh, it's beautiful anyhow. I enjoy it very much. Yes, you see, there are fish and humans walking together. Oh, that's great. That shows the unity of all beings. Yeah? You mean human can live also underwater like that? Yeah? Yeah, I believe it. We could do that. I had a disciple who was drowned in the water, and she was under there, and she can breathe. She says, it's normal. It's just nothing there. But after we take her out again, she realized that she was underwater, and she was so scared then. But she's still alive. Yeah.
怎样才能使自己相信轮回?
You don't need to believe it now. Wait until you die, then you believe. 而且不用马上相信了，不用相信师父的话，等一下就知道了。等一下死的时候马上就知道了，根本不用问题。现在相信还来得及，等那个时候来不及改变自己的情况和生活就是了。
Kính thưa sư phụ, trì ngũ giới và hành thập thiện, nhưng không tập thiền định sau khi chết, linh hồn có được giải thoát hay
không? Được lên trời chứ không được giải thoát. We cannot be liberated by keeping the precepts or doing virtuous deed alone. We can only be liberated when we know that we are liberated. You understand? That we know our nature is liberation. That we know truly that we are eternal. That is when we are liberated. We cannot be liberated when we are still blindly doing virtuous deeds. That means we still know there are things to be done. there are things to do to achieve liberation. This is not. We are still in ignorance. We do not know our real nature is liberation. Okay? You can keep as a 500 precepts or do a 10,000 virtuous deeds, not only 10 or 5, but you still cannot get liberation. It is to cook sand and hope in it to become rice. Yeah.
Thưa sư cô, mục đích cuối cùng của thiền định là giải thoát. Xin sư cô cho biết, người đã giải thoát có thật sự thoát khỏi tham sân si hay không?
Yes. Thật sự chứ. Mới nói lúc đầu sư phụ đã nói liền rồi. Ta giận nhưng mà không phải là giận. Tham không phải là tham. Hiểu chưa? Giận không phải giận như kiểu của mình. Giận mà ghen á, chồng đi kiếm vợ khác rồi ghét rồi giận rồi chém giết người ta. Hoặc là giận thì người ta lại không có cho tiền mình giận mình ghét. Cái chuyện đó là cái chuyện tầm thường của thế gian. Có thể là giận, thí dụ như con cái mình nó không làm cái điều đạo đức, mình giận à. Nhưng mà giận mà không có cái sự hận ở trong đó. Hoặc là những người gì làm những cái chuyện gì mà không có tốt đó, mình cảm thấy mình có thể sân si. Nhưng mà không phải sân si cái kiểu mà ích kỷ, hiểu chưa? Ông ấy muốn cho mình tốt, muốn tất cả tài sản về mình, rồi người ta không cho mình ghét. Hoặc là chồng bỏ đi rồi giận hờn rồi kiếm cách hại người ta, cái đó là khác, hiểu chưa? Còn cái chuyện sân si, nhưng mà có nhiều cái không phải là sân si, nhưng mà nó cái sự phản ứng với nhau thôi, hiểu chưa? Dù con cái mình nó làm chuyện bậy thì mình nhiều khi mình không giận mà mình tỏ vẻ giận cho nó biết, đặng mình dạy dỗ nó chứ. Nó chứ lúc nào cười cười hoài, nó muốn đi ăn trộm ăn cắp gì rồi nó đi sao, chuyện nó hỏi vậy sao được. Cái sân si của người tu nó khác với cái sân si của người phàm, quý vị có hiểu chưa? Sân si của người phàm là toàn là ích kỷ không à. À, cái gì cũng muốn cho mình hết, chứ không bao giờ mà muốn lợi cho người khác. Cái gì mà không có lợi cho mình là sân si, là ghét, là hận tới xương á, tìm cách hại người ta hết ngày này qua ngày kia. Cái đó là khác. Còn những người tu người ta sân si là nó khác, hiểu chưa? Sân si khi thấy người ta làm những chuyện quấy hại những người khác, rồi cái lòng nó cũng không có cái lòng không có được vui, hiểu chưa? Cái đó sân si không phải sân si vì ích kỷ, nhưng mà tại vì cái hoàn cảnh nó phản ứng ra như vậy thôi. Nhưng mà sân si không phải là ngày nào tháng nào cũng mặt mày ủ rũ tìm cách hại người đó, không phải như vậy. Là cái phản ứng tự nhiên của con người, cái đó là khác. Quý vị có hiểu chưa? Ok, tham sân si cũng vậy thôi, đại khái nó cũng như vậy hết. Ok, I said to her that in the beginning of the lecture I already said the enlightened person when he's angry is not real anger, you know, and he's not deeply shaken. Or the person who the anger directed toward is not affected like with hatred, with the negative atmosphere like the ordinary anger. You understand? And the enlightened person are never angry for selfish purpose. Nah? He never angry because you don't give him enough money or because you run away from him, that his wife run away to another man or vice versa, and he tried to chase her back and find other ways to harm that person, the rival. No, it's not like that. The enlightened person may appear to be angry, but for different purpose. For example, for the work of mankind, or to try to use apparent anger to push through some of the very dark Maya resistance. You understand? Sometimes you have to use so-called aggressive energy to break through it in order to work and to go through it and to advance in your mission. But that is different. He's not angry because nobody feed him or nobody give him money or nobody loves him. It's not true. It's not like that. It's not selfish. You understand? You cannot get away from anger. You must use it. There is a difference between a real anger and the one who is enlightened, who use anger as a weapon. It's just like a knife in the hand of the surgeon. It's different than in the hand of a murderer. It's still the same. It hurts. It bleeds, but it heals. And the surgeon know how much to cut and where and how long. But the murderer, he just blindly kills people out of hatred of his selfish interest. The same with anger, greed, and lust. I tell you, anger, greed, lust, and other so-called negative qualities all came from nirvana, all came from the kingdom of God. They are all the noble qualities. For example, why are we greedy for the things of this world? Because we came from the glorious kingdom of God. We are used to with it. We used to with glory. We used to with richness. We used to with with things that we don't want and no need to work. That's why we are mostly lazy, don't like to work. We just want money, we just want diamonds. This is correct. But we must know, in this world it's different, that's all. And we use this greed to push ourselves through this world in order to achieve the precious stone which is inside us, the wishful feeling gem. Greed is not bad, anger is not negative, lust is okay, just we have to use it in the right way. Use it as a tool to heal, not to kill. Then everything is okay, nothing is negative. It's our misconception that makes things negative.
For your enlightenment, did you have a master for yourself? Who are the other masters? How have you been enlightened in Kuan Yin? Who are the masters that are enlightened in a method other than Kuan Yin? Are they alive today?
Whew. We need a dictionary of who is who in America. Or who is who in the world. Look here. It doesn't concern you, okay, that much. If you want to know the Kuan Yin method, which I offer today, then please come. And concerning other masters, I'm not privileged to announce their name. I don't know if they want to, or they allow me to do so. I only know my business. In America, we say, mind your own business, okay? So, I mind my own business only. I know that the Kuan Yin method which I use is very good, it's excellent, and offer enlightenment in no time. It's safe, and you're protected while you're meditating, so you don't have trouble with demons. And you cannot have any side effect. And you get enlightenment quickly and safely, and in one lifetime. In this lifetime, I promise you are enlightened, you are liberated. This is the last life for you. And also your 5, 6, 7, 8 generation will be also looked after and liberated, even though the levels will not be the same as yours. But they are liberated nevertheless. And I also know, well, that maybe I'm enlightened. And other master, how do I know? Why should I mind other people's business? I have enough work to do. Now, if you do not believe that I am enlightened or that my method is good, then you're free to choose elsewhere. We have a big market nowadays, no? Masters are more than disciples.
Is it contrary to nature to work for healing of others and to alleviate suffering? Should one simply accept the suffering of others, such as the refugees, and not take part?
Just accept this, let them suffer, right?
Yeah, that's uh-huh. Or can we heal them or heal other people?
You mean healing by spiritual power? Healing by using spiritual force is unnatural. Yeah? We mess about with people's aura, with people's chakras, with people's spiritual magnetic field. Yeah, we mess it up. And it's difficult to correct later, and also mess up with the psychic nature of people. But if we try to help those who are in need and who calls to us for help, then it's not unnatural. You understand? It's like a doctor who uses a physical means of needles and knives and tubes and medicine to heal a person. It's not unnatural. And the doctor will not incur any bad karma through that. But if we mess about with people's spiritual magnetic field, then the bad karma is heavy. If you relieve the famine or if you help the refugees, that is okay. Because in the Bible it also says, be kind to strangers, do not oppress the strangers, for we are also the strangers in the land of Egypt. I mean, we are strangers in this earth too. And refugees situation, it may be ours soon also. We are at war now. We could be refugees also. So we should help others who are in need, that God might help us.
Thank you.
Supreme Master Qinghai's lectures are not a complete meditation instruction. Please do not try alone. For free of charge guidance, please visit www.godsdirectcontact.org or contact any of our centers near you.
It is our joy to have your company for today's episode of Words of Wisdom. Join us again tomorrow for the conclusion of Supreme Master Qinghai's lecture entitled The Way to Gain the Kingdom of God is Through Enlightenment. Coming up next is Golden Age Technology, right after Noteworthy News. Please stay tuned to Supreme Master Television. With heaven's blessings, may all beings on our beautiful planet coexist in peace, love, and happiness.
For more details, please visit www.suprememastertv.com/WOW.